According to these powerful people, Jesus came with a sword, not just words of peace. Check it out, leave your comments, ding the bell, share it with your friends, and subscribe to our channel. With you on the line with us is Jeff Sharlet. He is a professor at Dartmouth College. He's a journalist, author of 6 books, including The Family, The Secret Fundamentalism at the Heart of American Power, his latest, This Brilliant Darkness. He's also the executive producer of the Netflix series, The Family, 5-part miniseries. And you'll see my face in there when you watch it. It's absolutely brilliant. And if you haven't seen it now, write it down and put it on your list. It's called The Family. It's on Netflix. His Twitter handle is Jeff Sharlet, Sharlet. Jeff, welcome back to the program, and thanks for being with us. I'm wondering if you could speak. I've been talking this morning about the historic role of how fascism interacts with functions, with groups. We just had a long conversation, a good conversation with Professor Richard Wolff about how the big corporations and the economy in Germany in the 1930s and Hitler kind of interpenetrated each other. Can you speak to the historic role of right-wing Christianity in the rise of fascism?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of questions right now. People looking at Trump holding that Bible, a Bible, not his Bible, outside St. John's Church and saying, how can we stand the hypocrisy? And that's ignoring the fact that, and particularly in the United States and particularly in, but not exclusively, white evangelicalism, there has long been a power tradition and an idea that sees in Christ not the lamb, not this loving figure, but a strong man, and is looking for a worldly counterpart. And Trump has found that and embraces Trump as a strong man. And along with that comes a sort of an ease with white nationalism, with corporate power and so on. But at the heart of it is this idea of an all-encompassing power.
Now, a lot of Americans who aren't familiar with your work or haven't been paying close attention to these kind of things would say, well, how can the white evangelicals embrace Donald Trump? He's had 3 wives. He cheated on every single one of them in various ways at various times that have now come out. He has declared bankruptcy 6 times. He's ripped off literally thousands of people based on over 3,000 lawsuits for his, failing to pay contractors and things. He is, in so many ways, the definition of somebody who is the not just not a Christian, but the antithesis of the teachings of Jesus, particularly in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 25. It must just be that they're hooking up with him because he's said he's going to protect their tax-exempt status or something. There's got to be some self-interest here. Can you speak to what the real connection is in this whole King Cyrus meme that's floating through the right with the conservative Christian community?
Yeah, well, let me back up just a little bit before I get to King Cyrus and, this idea of who Trump is because you said particularly in the Sermon on the Mount. Well, that's what you say, Tom, particularly in the Sermon on the Mount. We're also talking about the Christ who says, I come not to bring peace, but the sword. There's more than one way to read Jesus. And they, again, this I really think is important, is what they read in Jesus is strength and power. And so it's not as hypocritical for them as it seems, but it is. There is an element of transactional, and I think that's an element that those of us on the left and secular folks need to understand too. As we say, how can they do this? Well, they're not dummies. They have ends that they want to achieve, and remember, it's not just about tax breaks. It's about transformation of U.S. law at every level. And, you look at the Trump administration as Ralph Reed, longtime Christian right political operative, key figure, says we have more of more Christians, by which he means right-wing political fundamentalists, more Christians in government than we have ever had before. And that's actually true. I mean, not more Christians, more fundamentalists. That's true. So they're getting a lot of bang for their buck. But they do then go take this theological turn that you refer to, King Cyrus. King Cyrus in the Bible is not a he's a goy. He's not one of the Israelites, and yet he plays a sort of instrumental role for the Israelites. And in this sense, they can look at at Trump and have embraced Trump. And by the way, this comes from Isaiah 45, and Trump is president number 45. Coincidence, you know, I think not is that thinking, right? Is that Trump is like Cyrus. Trump is a tool used by God. And in fact, his very ungodliness, the very all the ways in which he seems, you know, thrice married, as people like to say, and you know, everything, this is proof of God's goodness. If this guy can be elected, God must surely be doing it, right? God's hand must be in play here. And look, they're being proven right all the time. They're getting what they want, right down to that walk across Lafayette Park to St. John's Church, which was a performance of the merger of state power, of violent power, and of Christian power that they've been looking for. You know, they put their faith in this tool, and it's been rewarded.
Yeah. It's been a lot of years since I lived in Germany. That was the 87, 88. But and read William Shearer's The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. But my recollection is that Hitler, with his Reichsbishop Müller, was his name, or Müller, that Hitler was actually fairly effective at manipulating Christian sentiment. And I'm guessing, and I'm no student of this, and I'm not sure if you are either, but I'm guessing that Mussolini did as well in Italy. And I'm not sure, frankly, about Franco in Spain. Is this something that you've ever looked into, Jeff?
Franco in Spain was a right-wing Catholic dictatorship. That's what it was. And, yeah, these kinds of collaborations have always been there. I find them actually a little bit less useful, the German context, the Italian context, the Spanish context. You could also say Suharto in the Indonesian context and the use of Islam. We could look at Erdogan in Turkey, sort of a proto-Trump right now, and his use of a kind of hyper-capitalist, far-right version of Islam. You need to look at the American context. It does us no good to say that what Trump is doing was like Nazi Germany, because what Trump is doing is like Trump. This is the moment we confront right now. And if I worry that sometimes on the left, we spend too much time trying to neatly line this up with bad events in the past, and it's blinding us to the particular nuances of the moment. Particular aspects of the American right, one of which is really historic and often sort of under-commented on, is the alliance of right-wing white evangelicals and right-wing Catholics. Protestantism and Catholicism historically haven't gotten along very well. But you look at a guy like Bill Barr, who's a right-wing Catholic, working with a guy like Mike Pompeo, who's a right-wing evangelical, and you see a coalition and an alliance and a kind of a new theology being formed. That doesn't have a precedent in Germany, Italy, or Spain. That's happening right now. And if we're going to understand it and identify the fault lines within it, we want to be informed by history, but not trying to pour this into a mold.
Sure, yeah. A good point, and I take your point. At the same time, we're seeing, I believe that there's not a single Protestant on the Supreme Court right now, and all or most of the Catholics are members of this Opus Dei Church in D.C. Is this something that we should be concerned about?
Well, Opus Dei is not a church. Opus Dei is it's an interesting sort of entity within Catholicism. I believe founded in 1935, same year as the group I've written so much about, The Family, which sponsors the National Prayer Breakfast, and both emerging at this moment when they're looking around the world and they see fascism here and they see communism, Stalinism there, and they see what they perceive as the weak response of the democracies. They think democracy is not enough. They're certainly not going to be communist, but they also don't want to be fascist. What they don't like about fascism is the displacement of God as a central figure by a Führer or Mussolini and so on. And so they develop what they see as this kind of third way. That Catholic tradition develops a much more intellectual and draws from a much more intellectual tradition. And that's, you know, I think that's big part of why the judiciary, the right-wing judiciary, is dominated by right-wing Catholics. There's an intellectual tradition for them to draw on. I wouldn't make too much of their affiliation with Opus Dei. I'd make a hell of a lot more of the decisions that they are issuing from the bench. You know, in other words, it's right out there in the open. We don't need to look behind the screen. Trump is putting it right out there for us to see.